Good morning, everybody, and thank you for joining us for our Exploring Your Surrogacy Options webinar. My name is Amanda Caroca. I am the program manager here at Circle, and I'm a licensed social worker. We're also going to hear from Scott Buckley, who's our director of operations. He's also an attorney in the U.S. And finally, we'll hear from Stephen Page, an Australian attorney, about the relevant laws pertaining to Australia. Just a couple of housekeeping tips. You can listen in by your phone or by using your computer speakers. You will be on mute, but feel free to type any questions you have while we're speaking into that questions box, and we'll give you the opportunity to ask more questions, and we'll answer all of the questions at the end of our webinar. And just so you know, we'll be recording it, and we'll send it to you after the webinar via email. Some of the things that we'll cover tonight, I will talk to you a little bit about Circle as an agency, our history and background. We'll talk a little bit about the different services that we offer, as well as the process of finding an egg donor and a surrogate and walking through the process, as well as the different programs that we offer. Scott Buckley will talk to you more about insurance, costs, and legal work. And like I said, we'll hear from Stephen Page more about the laws pertaining to Australia. And of course, we'll leave time at the end to answer any questions you have. So a couple of things about Circle. We are one of the oldest agencies and one of the largest agencies in the world regarding surrogate parenting. John Wiltman is our president and founder. He's pictured at the right there. He is an attorney, and he's recognized worldwide as an expert in reproductive law. He is a parent through surrogacy as well. He has two sons who are now in college. He began surrogacy legal work back in 1991, and out of that, he created Circle Surrogacy in 1995. So why Circle Surrogacy? Some of the things that set us apart from different agencies. And this is something that you should consider when you're researching agencies. Think about the aspects of the agency that are most important to you. So I'll talk specifically about Circle here. Like I mentioned, we are one of the largest agencies. We have brought into the world more than 1,100 babies. I believe we're nearing our 1,200th baby very soon. We like to celebrate that quite a bit. We have a nearly 100% success rate. So we are willing to stick with you, our intended parents, as long as you're willing to stick with us, no matter what happens, until you have a live baby in your arms. Now, along the surrogacy process, lots of things can happen, good things and bad things. And we have a couple of services that are included in our programs to offer our intended parents a little bit more security. One of those things is an unlimited IVF program. We partner with certain IVF clinics that offer unlimited IVF packages, which are basically all-inclusive packages. So no matter what happens medically throughout the process related to your egg donor, your surrogate, whether or not you have a miscarriage, whether or not you need two surrogates, all of that would be included in an unlimited IVF program for one price that you would pay upfront. Now, unlimited matching means that, you know, sometimes you may have an egg donor or a surrogate that may not work out for medical reasons or for another personal reason. And while we never like that to happen, we can't necessarily control people's lives and biology. So at Circle, what we do is we don't charge you again if that happens to you. So we wouldn't ask you to pay an additional agency fee if you needed a second surrogate or a second egg donor. And the last thing that we do to offer security to our intended parents is that we are now offering a fixed fee program. You know, surrogacy is such a scary thing, or it can be a scary thing. There's a lot of processes involved, and it can be quite complicated, and we can't necessarily predict exactly what will happen. So with the fixed fee program, what that means is that, again, you'll be paying one price up front, and you know what to expect financially. You know what you'll be paying no matter what happens throughout the process. Another thing that separates Circle from other agencies is that we are experts in international surrogacy. I believe nearly 60% of our intended parents come from other countries, or countries other than the United States. We have attorneys on staff who are well-versed in international law, and we also have partnerships with attorneys in other countries. Because when you go back home with your baby, you want to make sure that that process is very safe and secure for you, and that you can complete all of the paperwork back home once you have your baby. So with that being said, we do work with intended parents from all backgrounds. We work around the world. We work with intended parents who are single. We work with intended parents who are coupled, same-sex couples, heterosexual couples, different ethnicities. We're willing to work with everybody, with a diverse population. We also have a SPAR program. SPAR stands for a Special Program of Assisted Reproduction. That is a special program for intended parents who are HIV positive. There's a special process that those intended parents can go through to basically wash the biology while they're creating their embryo so that it's safe to transfer to a gestational surrogate so that there's no harm to the surrogate and you're still able to provide biology and be the biological parent of your child. We also emphasize known egg donation, which I'll speak about in a minute, and we focus on relationships here. We like to get to know our intended parents very well. We will work with you very closely. This is a very personal process, a very human process to have a baby, and so we want to make sure that we're getting to know you and how you work and how your family works very well. And we also want all of our intended parents to have a relationship with their gestational surrogate. This is not a business transaction. You're not going to pay money and pick up your baby at the end. We really want you to get to know your surrogate throughout the process. And a lot of intended parents are surprised to know that they can be a part of the process. They can attend ultrasound appointments. They can meet their surrogate at the IVF clinic, and they can make decisions for their baby or for the pregnancy as they go along. Of course, we will offer you support throughout the process. We are a full-service agency, so not only will we find you an egg donor or a surrogate, but we'll help you with all of the legal work. We'll provide all of the coordination throughout the process so that you don't have to worry about those things. And we will help you with long-term planning. Not just for the good things, not just for the buying the baby clothes at the end, but for the hard things as well. And we will always offer guidance if something difficult happens based on our expertise and our experience. So there are three components of a surrogacy journey that underlie everything that we do here and that we think are so important that we actually need to tell you about them tonight, or this morning, excuse me. The first is communication. We want you to communicate with us. We're not able to read your mind. So if something is not going well for you, we ask that you tell us. If we see something that's not going well, of course we'll tell you and help you problem solve. Not only do we want you to talk to us, but we want you to speak to your surrogate as well. Like I mentioned, we are a relationship-based agency, and we always say that if you want your surrogate to be doing this for more than just money, you have to give her more than just money. So we want you to be communicating with her. You are able to attend different appointments, and we want you to form that relationship. Now, in terms of trust, of course, we want you to trust us. We've been doing this for more than 20 years now. We've seen pretty much everything, and we're able to provide you with our experience whenever you cross a certain bridge in the process. But we also do have a process in place for a reason, and the people that have great success throughout this process are the ones that trust us and follow what we say. And not only do we want you to trust us, we want you to trust your surrogate. These surrogates are the ones who are good at being pregnant. A lot of times they have multiple children, they've been pregnant before, they know what to expect, and they can help guide you through the process as well. So it's really important that you're able to trust her. And finally, letting go of control. So there are a lot of things that you can control in surrogacy. You can control whether or not you want to work with an agency, which agency you choose, who your egg donor is, who your surrogate is, who your IVF doctor is. But once you put all of those things in place, the journey takes on a life of its own. And there are a lot of things that we cannot control at that point. We can't control biology as much as we would like to, and we can't control everything that will happen. So we ask that you are able to let go of control. And if that's something that's difficult for you, we encourage you to talk to us about that so we can best support you. Now, we categorize the services that we offer into two different acronyms. There's GS and there's GSED. GS stands for gestational surrogacy. That means that you would be coming to us or that you would require the assistance of a gestational surrogate. So you may be providing all of the biology to create your embryos. You may have an egg donor somewhere else, but you would ask for a surrogate from Circle. And we would help match you with a surrogate that meets all of your legal needs, your psychological needs, and your emotional needs. We also offer gestational surrogacy with egg donation. So the people that enter that program are those that would need an egg donor, and you're able to select an egg donor either through Circle, through our network of egg donors. We also have partnership agreements with other agencies in the United States and also with IVF clinics. So you have a large range of options for you. And of course, we would also match you with a surrogate. Again, that meets your legal, psychological, and emotional needs. So a little bit about the surrogacy process. When you're ready to move forward, we will help facilitate all of the next steps. First would be a consultation. So when you're ready, you would ask for a consultation where we would speak to you on a more personalized basis about what you're looking for in terms of an egg donor, a surrogate, your program needs, your financial background. And we would talk to you about the services that we can offer you. Once you're ready to sign on to Circle, of course, we would welcome you. And we would assign you a program coordination team. And that's actually the team that I manage, so I know it very well. The program coordination team would be made up of a program manager and a program coordinator. And those two people are your two people at Circle. They are the ones that are facilitating all of the communication between you, your egg donor, your surrogate, the IVF clinic, the insurance companies. Like I mentioned, there are a lot of different components, and so you need to be able to trust those people that are helping you throughout the process. And of course, you would also have access to the intended parent support team. If you have some more emotional concerns, or if there's something that's not quite going well for you, you would speak to a member of the intended parent support team who would be able to offer you additional guidance and support. If you need help choosing an IVF clinic, we have the ability to recommend a clinic for you. We are willing to work with any IVF doctor across the United States as long as they are willing to work with us and understand the coordination that an agency would provide. But if you need help with choosing an IVF clinic, we could make recommendations and we could help you connect with different doctors. If you are someone that requires the assistance of an egg donor, we would help you with that process. We have a whole department related to matching intended parents with egg donors, and we would talk to you about what you're looking for in an egg donor, what's important to you. We would be able to speak to your doctor about different egg donors if we have medical records on file and help match you with an egg donor. And same with surrogate matching. Surrogate is one of the most important people involved in this process. Again, we have a whole nother department related to just the matching between intended parents and surrogates, and we want to make sure that you're comfortable with that match, especially because you will be having a relationship with her going forward. And then we offer journey coordination, which I think is one of the, when intended parents, especially international intended parents, are thinking about a surrogacy journey, that's something that they need a lot of guidance on, because there's a lot of moving parts involved and they're not quite sure what they need to do. So those are the services that we provide. We tell you what you need to do and when, where you need to go, where the egg donor and surrogate needs to go, and we'll walk you through the process step by step. So in terms of program coordination, I just spoke a little bit about this, but we understand that this is complicated. We understand that there's a lot of moving parts. And for an intended parent from another country who may not understand how a hospital works in the United States or how the insurance works in the United States, we know that it can be very scary. So that's what we're here for. We will welcome you in addition to the surrogate and the donor once they're in the picture and help get you settled into the program and your IVF doctor. We will help connect you and facilitate communication with the insurance companies, with the IVF clinic, with the different lawyers involved. We will arrange travel for a gestational surrogate and an egg donor when they need to travel to the IVF clinic for their medical screening or the IVF process. We will handle payments for both a surrogate and an egg donor, because when you sign a contract with them, you're agreeing to certain payments to be made to them. So we will take care of all of that for you. And then the final step that we'll take care of is a hospital preparation. We will call the hospital where the baby will be born and ensure that they understand that this is a surrogacy and that you feel prepared going into the birth of your baby. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our surrogates and what our screening process entails. We at Circle have high standards. We accept about 1 to 2% of the women who start the application process. When a woman wants to be a surrogate, she'll fill out an application online initially, and then they'll move through our screening process with our social workers, and in the end, we accept about 1 to 2% of the women that start an application. We want these women to be motivated to help other people, and we see a lot of women who sign up to be a surrogate because they want to help another couple. Like I mentioned earlier, the women that apply are those who are good at being pregnant. They have easy pregnancies. They glow throughout their pregnancies, and they want to help another couple have a baby. A couple of the things that we're looking for when we see an application. Number one is health. We want to make sure that they have a healthy BMI, their height to weight ratio. And a lot of the health guidelines are based on what our clinics will accept. So that's one thing, is the BMI. They also have to have given birth to a healthy child, and your IVF doctor will pre-approve her medical records. Something more basic is that they have to be between the ages of 21 and 41 years of age. They also have to pass a psychological screening with a licensed psychologist. And that screening is usually required by every IVF doctor. They also have to live in a state in the United States where that is surrogacy friendly, meaning if we ever needed to go to court — this hasn't happened, but if we ever needed to go to court — we could uphold a contract between an intended parent and a surrogate. We expect surrogates to have the support of their family and friends, because this is not just a process about her. Her partner may have to stay home and watch her children while she goes to the IVF doctor. And her mother may need to watch her children while she's in the hospital having a baby. And so if their family and friends are not supportive or not involved in the process, it won't work. So we're looking for that support. We're making sure that she has that in place. And one other health criteria that I forgot to mention is that we don't accept surrogates who use illegal drugs, smoke cigarettes, or abuse alcohol. I'm going to talk a little bit now about our egg donors. We have about 540 egg donors on our website, and we also work with three other agencies around the United States that have additional egg donors. If you wanted to match with one of their egg donors, you could do so at no additional charge to you. We will work with you to figure out what you're looking for your egg donor, and then help match you accordingly. We do have a database online that you're able to access if you'd like. When we receive an egg donor application, a couple of our requirements include an age requirement. They must be between the ages of 20 and 29. They cannot have a body mass index of higher than 28 to 30. And again, that's based on what our IVF doctors will accept. They should have a healthy family history. So we ask them about different diseases in their family and their parent and the grandparent medical history. And you can see that online as well. We won't accept a donor who uses illegal drugs for cigarettes or abuses alcohol. And we ask that they have a minimum of a high school degree. So if you were to go onto our database, this is what it would look like. You would be able to search, and you can see at the top that gray box, the different criteria that you can put in if you're looking for something specific. You can look for hair color, eye color, their height, their age, their weight. A lot of intended parents want an egg donor who looks like them or looks like the parent who may not be contributing biology to the embryos, and that's okay, that's normal. And so you can look and put in that criteria and see if there's any egg donors that may look like you. You can search by education, you can search by ethnic background or their location. And finally, you can search by whether or not they're a previous donor. And we list that on our website. So if somebody is listed as a previous donor, you'll be able to see that. And we would be able to give you the results of their previous donation. We don't advertise that on our website, but if you inquire about a specific donor, we would be able to provide that information for you. Now, when you're considering an egg donor, there's another decision you'll have to make, along with all of the other decisions throughout the process. And this is the kind of match that you would like to have. Circle is known for our known egg donation. And what known donation means is that you have the opportunity to speak with an egg donor. You can meet with her in person if you'd like and exchange contact information with the egg donor. And we promote known donation for a couple of different reasons. First, in the event that your child would like to meet the donor in the future. Now, not every child wants to meet their donor. They may not be curious at all. But with a known donation, you're opening the door so that in the future, if your child wants to meet the egg donor, you already have direct access to her and you could just facilitate that meeting. And second, we promote it for medical reasons. Your donor may not know that there's a specific disease or medical history in her family at this point or at the point of donation. But let's pretend that you have a daughter out of this process. And 10 years from now, your donor finds out that there's breast cancer in her family. If you have a direct relationship with this egg donor, the donor could provide that information to you. And if there is breast cancer and you have a daughter at home, you're going to want that information. So again, you don't have to have an ongoing relationship with her, but you're leaving the door open in the event that you want that. The second kind of donation is a semi-known donation. So if you don't feel comfortable exchanging full contact information or making your contract with her fully known, you could go with a semi-known donation. You would still have the option to speak with her once or twice, and we could help arrange a Skype or a phone call. We would help you sort of hide your contact information with that. But the legal contract between you and the egg donor would be considered anonymous, where we wouldn't share your last names or other identifying information. And then finally, we have anonymous donation, where that means that you would not have contact with the egg donor, and you would not exchange any contact information at all, and the legal agreement between you and the egg donor would be completely anonymous. You wouldn't share your last name or other contact information, and you wouldn't speak to her. So no matter which kind of donation you choose, that's okay. It's a personal decision for you and your family, and we'll work with you, and all of our egg donors are willing to be known. But they're also accepting a semi-known or an anonymous donation. So it's really a personal decision that you'll have to make from your family. I'm going to turn this over now to Scott Buckley, our Director of Operations and an attorney here at Circle, and he'll speak to you more about the insurance aspects, the legal aspects, and financial aspects of a surrogacy.
Okay, thank you, Amanda. So just as a very quick introduction, as Amanda said, my name is Scott Buckley. I'm an attorney and the Director of Operations. I've worked at Circle for about 13 years now. And so my job, in addition to running the day-to-day operations, I also am one of the main people that do consultations. And so we're going to talk a little bit later about consultations and when they're going to be available. And, you know, if anybody's interested in speaking with us, I would love to give you guys more information. But today I just want to go over very briefly the general considerations to think about regarding insurance, how to get home, establish your parental rights, and the cost of a surrogacy journey in the United States. Beginning with insurance, when I talk about insurance, what I'm really speaking about is how we will help limit your liability for medical expenses in the U.S. And there are two main medical expenses you will incur outside of the IVF procedures. The first are the medical bills of the surrogate herself for her maternity. So that is the cost of going to the doctor during the pregnancy, and most importantly, the actual cost of the delivery itself. Secondly, will be the cost of the child or the children born in the United States. When we talk about the maternity coverage, every surrogate that works with Circle will end up having maternity insurance in place. The real question is, how does that happen? Many of the women that apply to us already have insurance in place, and if they do, we have 8 lawyers at Circle. What we will do is we will review her insurance policy to look and ensure that there's maternity coverage and that there are no exclusions for surrogacy. If we say that her insurance is good insurance, then we will just try to use her insurance to cover the medical expenses. If a surrogate does not already have her own insurance policy in place, we will make sure that she gets insurance in place one way or another. Most likely what we will do is make use of the Affordable Care Act insurance plans in the United States. And in a consultation, I will bore you much more than this about how we do that. But generally, just understand that there will be an insurance plan in place that we will bill all of her maternity and delivery bills to. For the dependent coverage, it's a little more complicated. For United States intended parents, the dependent coverage is very simple, because U.S. intended parents will simply add the children that are born to their own insurance policies. Unfortunately, for our international intended parents, which, as Amanda said, is about 60% of our intended parents, most international clients do not have insurance that will cover their children in the United States. So if that's the case, then we have to have a plan for how to cover the medical bills. Well, that plan really varies depending upon whether or not you would like to have a single child or twins. If you are having just a single child, typically the medical expenses are only about $2,000 to $3,000. The chance of major complications occurring in a singleton pregnancy are very small. So in this instance, we talk a lot about our fast match program, where we will ensure that the surrogate has insurance to cover her maternity, but the main plan will be that you would just cover the medical bills of the surrogate yourself, assuming they're $2,000 to $3,000. In the maybe 1% chance that there are high medical bills, there are insurance policies that we could potentially put in place when the child is born. I don't like to rely on that as a primary option, but it is something that we can help in a pinch. But generally, the fast match program is reserved for intended parents that say they would just like one child, and it also can help to speed up the legal work because we don't have to use the surrogate's insurance to cover the children. Excuse me. Many other intended parents would like to have twins. That could be because you were working with embryos that are not of the best quality and the doctor recommends putting more than one embryo in. It could be that you're a same-sex couple and both of you would like to be genetic parents, and you can fertilize half of the egg donor's eggs with each of your sperm and put one of each father in. Whatever the reason, if you try for twins, the risks are much greater because the medical expenses are much greater. Twins, on average, are born about one month early. About half of them end up in an intensive care unit, and the average medical bill there is almost $100,000. Therefore, it is important that you have insurance in place and that we don't scramble at the end to get something in place. There are options to purchase insurance that will specifically cover a surrogate pregnancy and to cover a child. The problem is those are very expensive plans, and for the dependent coverage for twins, those plans will cost more than $100,000. Therefore, that is not an affordable option for most intended parents. Some agencies will tell you you can rely on an Obamacare plan to be purchased after the child is born. I also don't like that option because it's not in place already. There are a lot of, let's say, questionable candidates running for president in the United States right now, and I'm not positive that Obamacare plans will necessarily be around in a year or year and a half or 2 years when you may need that coverage. And so I think it's risky to achieve a pregnancy anticipating that a plan will be in place for purchase a year and a half from now. I would much rather have an insurance plan in place. For that reason, the only thing that I would recommend would be our standard match program. And in the standard match program, we review the surrogate's insurance, not just for maternity coverage, but also to make sure that we believe it would also cover the children born to her. What that means is we are looking at the definition of a child in the insurance plan. If the insurance plan says it will cover her genetic children or her biological children, we cannot argue that the surrogate's baby born to her is her genetic child. On the other hand, if it covers a baby born to her or her natural child, you can argue that. So it's very important to make sure that if you're having twins, that you are thinking about the insurance considerations and working with an agency that will make sure that you have insurance in place. Excuse me. With insurance, one of the main concerns are what happens if there are problems? What are the potential risks to using that one, to using the insurance? Insurance costs will vary depending upon the plan. Basically, for insurance, you're going to run into a few different types of expenses. There's going to be an expense to get the insurance plan in place, whether you pay the surrogate a higher fee for having her own insurance, or whether you pay the premiums for a policy for her. There will also be a portion that the patient needs to pay that you would have to reimburse her. 5 years ago, these were minimal amounts. Today, they can be $4,000 or $5,000 deductibles, which must be paid before there's any insurance in place. There are also insurances that will cover the risk to an egg donor during the retrieval process or a surrogate for the transfer process. There's a life insurance plan in place. We will ensure that all of these insurances get in place, but they do come with an expense. If there are any issues that come up, part of the fees that you pay to us include our work to fight appeals, work with medical providers, work with the surrogate's employer, if there are any issues that come up. This is another distinction between Circle and other agencies. Many agencies will simply refer you to outside attorneys or outside insurance brokers and hope that everything goes well. We have the 8 lawyers here, and part of what we do is stand by the policies that we say should work. We also now have a company called NES Assurance that helps our intended parents. And what they do is they ensure that the medical bills are being properly billed by having their registered nurses review it. They build a portal that you and your surrogate can sign into, which will allow you to review all the medical bills. And if you need local monitoring for a surrogate or a donor, they will negotiate discounted rates for that. Altogether, when we talk about insurance, I would tell you to plan about $15,000 for the insurance cost. And when we talk about cost at the end, that is a piece of that. Now, moving on to the legal aspects. Excuse me. Really, when we think about legal, there are three things that I think about. First are the contracts with the donor and the surrogate. Second, how do we establish your parental rights, both in the United States and then at home? And third, how do you return home? How do you get home? What documents do you need? With regards to the contracts, Circle will represent the intended parents. We do not represent the carriers and the donors. They will have independent attorneys. If they don't have their own attorney already, we have a number of attorneys that we can recommend for them. The goal of the contract is not to win the deal. The goal of the contract is to make sure that everybody is on the same page. So we appreciate that there's often changes back and forth from the intended parents or the carriers or the donors. That actually improves the process, because then if something comes up, we understand that everybody has thought about this and everybody has agreed to what will happen if, you know, A occurs, then B is the result. We will also make sure that for international intended parents in particular, it's very important to make sure that the carriers and the donors will agree up front to help establish your parental rights at the end. In some countries, that may mean going to a consulate. It could be just simply signing papers, but we want to make sure that whatever is needed by them to establish your rights, they agree to do. In terms of establishing your rights, in the U.S., there are many options on how we do legal work. And what I mean by that is, we could, before the baby's even born, go to court and establish the parental rights of the intended parents and put both names on the initial birth certificate. We could do that after the birth of the child. We could put just one parent on with the surrogate, or one parent alone. What really matters is what you need. Stephen Page is going to talk a great deal about what it is that you need. If you would work with Circle, we would work with Stephen before we even present a surrogate to you, so that we understand exactly what it is that you need. He may say that it's best for you both to be on the birth certificate before you return to Australia. He may say that it's best not to be on the birth certificate. Laws change, so we will continue to check in with local counsel before we match you. And depending upon what you need will depend upon where your surrogate can be from, because in the United States, of the 45 states that allow surrogacy, each of them has a different process. So a lawyer will review any potential match with a surrogate before it is made to ensure that you have exactly what you need. The other thing to think about parental rights is insurance can actually impact it. If you recall, when we talked about twins, the goal would be to use the surrogate's insurance to cover the children. If that's the case, that limits what you can do legally, because you cannot terminate the surrogate's rights and continue using the surrogate's insurance. So you would not be able to do a pre-birth order to put your names on the original birth certificate without the carrier and then use her insurance to cover the children. So that is something that we think about before any match is made. And in a consultation, we would discuss in much more detail what the goal would be for you. The last thing to think about is citizenship and how you return home. Every child born in the United States is entitled to U.S. citizenship. Every child born in the United States is entitled to a U.S. passport. You would need to speak with Attorney Page about the best way to return back to Australia. With many countries, it's simplest to return on a U.S. passport and then simply register when you get home. But you should speak with Stephen, and I know he's going to speak with you today briefly about exactly how you go about doing that. The main concern many people have about surrogacy in the United States is the cost. There is no doubt that surrogacy in the United States is the safest, most secure way to do surrogacy. There is also no question that it is the most expensive way. When you think about the cost of surrogacy, there are four different types of expenses. There are agency fees, carrier and donor fees and expenses, IVF costs, and insurance expenses. When you think about the agency fees, different agencies do different things. Unfortunately, in the United States, there is nothing that as an agency has to do to be considered a surrogate agency. So you could be a former intended parent and start your own agency. You could be a former surrogate and start your own agency. You could be a lawyer. We think that the right agencies have lawyers involved, they have social workers involved, they have accountants involved, so that all of them are participating in the process as a means to protect you. Circle is a full service agency. We have almost 50 employees here, including 8 attorneys, I believe 8 or 9 social workers, 5 women in the accounting department. So we have a large staff to help you. Circle is also all inclusive. What all that means is we charge a little bit more upfront to include whatever services you need. So if you ever need an additional transfer, we don't charge you more to be our client longer. If you ever need a new surrogate or a new egg donor, we will match you again for free. We will do the legal work again for free. The lawyers that represent the carriers and the donors will do that for free. The social workers that do the screening, both inside and outside of Circle, will do that for free. So if your concern is that the cost will continue to expand, that is a concern with many agencies. Circle has thought about that, and in our pricing, we have included all of the additional services that you may need. The second type of expense that you will deal with are the carrier and donor's actual expenses and fees. Carriers and donors will have a base fee, but that is not all that they are paid. We will have limits on what expenses they can receive, but every journey is going to be different. If a surrogate gets pregnant on the first transfer, it will be cheaper than if it takes two or three transfers because you have to pay the carrier each time to go to the transfer. If the carrier never goes on bed rest, it's cheaper than if she does go on bed rest. With twins, it's more expensive. With twins, a carrier, a surrogate will typically get paid about $5,000 more, and there's a much higher risk of bed rest occurring and of a C-section occurring, in which case, again, there will be contingent costs that are that you would have to pay. Last year, we had a number of intended parents ask us if there was a way in which we could offer a fixed fee program, even including the carrier and the donor's expenses. I'm happy to say that the answer now is yes. We have a fixed fee program where instead of just collecting what we think you would owe and then you pay anything over that, we collect what we think you would owe plus a little bit more. And then Circle is actually the one that will be taking on the risk of those extra expenses. So with the fixed fee program, if a surrogate, for example, had a miscarriage 2 or 3 months in, even though Circle would never charge you again for a new surrogate, you would have paid a carrier 2 or 3 months of her base fee that would have been lost because you now have to pay a new carrier for the same expenses. Well, in the fixed fee program, Circle makes that payment. In the fixed fee program, if you need a new egg donor, Circle will actually pay the next donor as well. We would pay the travel. So it's a shared risk program, essentially, where we understand that over the course of 200 clients, 200 intended parents, that the average travel may be $10,000. But within that average, there are intended parents that pay $8,000 or $6,000 or $1,000. On the other hand, there are intended parents that pay $20,000 or $25,000 if it's taking multiple transfers to get pregnant. The third category of expense are IVF costs. Intended parents may choose to work with any IVF clinic they want. Generally speaking, I would say that the cost to create embryos at an IVF clinic and do the first transfer, including all the FDA screenings and the medications, is probably about $25,000. That, of course, can vary depending on the clinic, depending on the location of the clinic. Many IVF clinics now are offering package deals where you may purchase 3 transfers or 2 retrievals or whatever it may be up front, and you pay a higher fee up front, and that would include a certain number of transfers. One of the main IVF clinics that we work with offers an unlimited IVF package for a little more than $37,000. For that, if you ever need additional retrievals, additional transfers, you never pay more. All the medications, all the screenings are included. PGS testing, which is a genetic testing to try to tell if there are any chromosomal problems with the embryos and just to determine, you know, which are the best quality embryos, PGS testing is not included in these packages, and it's typically about $6,000 more. The last category of expense is the insurance, and we talked a great deal about the insurance already. As previously noted, I would tell you that it would be about $15,000 for insurance. And again, that can vary based upon what the specific plan that the surrogate has is, and also whether or not she may have used some of that deductible for her own family. If she has, then you wouldn't have to pay that. Excuse me. On Circle Surrogacy's website, which is, I believe, circlesurrogacy.com, you can find a cost sheet that is specific to what you need, whether or not you need an egg donor or not, whether or not you need, whether or not you're interested in the fast match program or the standard match program. In general, Circle will always collect everything that is owed for the surrogacy process, with the exception of the IVF clinic. With some clinics, that money is paid through us as well. If you would like, for safety reasons, you can always pay it through us. But some IVF clinics, you do not have to pay through us. So if you're just looking at the fees for the agency, the carrier and the donor, and the insurance cost, if you only need a surrogate, the cost is probably about $100,000 to $105,000. Could it be less than that? Yes. In particular, if you keep travel down, you can make that cost a little bit lower. But on our cost sheet, we put the average expenses, not the lowest potential cost. If you need an egg donor as well, what we consider a GSED program, I would tell you that you would expect about $125,000. IVF is not included in those numbers, so depending on the clinic that you choose, you would add that cost on top of it to get your total expense. And the only things that are not included on our cost estimates are your own travel expenses and any expenses that you incur for legal work in your own country. So if you hire Stephen Page for, you know, to help you in Australia, then anything that you would pay to him is not estimated on our cost sheet because you would pay that directly to him. Now, I'll turn this over to Stephen in just a moment, but I want to talk very briefly about our consultations. Our consultations take about 2.5 to 3 hours. They are free. We can do them on Skype or we can do them in person. The first part of the consultation will be with somebody like Amanda, who will go over in detail the process that Circle goes through in finding and matching you with surrogates and donors and the screening and the support that we do. The second part will be with an attorney at Circle, such as myself, and again, I will go over in much more detail the insurance issues, the legal aspects of surrogacy, and the cost. If you are interested in meeting with us, we are going to be in Australia at the end of May and the beginning of June. We'll be in Sydney May 27th to the 29th, in Melbourne May 31st to June 1st. And in Brisbane on the 3rd and 6th of June because of the conference that we're attending on the 4th and 5th. So if you're interested, you can reach out to the address here on the sheet here, and we would love to meet with you. Now we're going to turn it over to Stephen, and we have to unmute Stephen here. And Stephen Page is really the only attorney that we work with from Australia. And, you know, if you were going to do surrogacy in Australia, I would highly recommend that you work with Stephen as an advisor throughout the process.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone, for those here in Australia. As you can immediately tell, my accent is completely different from the previous speakers. I title this, When Not If You'll Become Parents, because one of the features about surrogacy is that it is certain that you'll become parents through surrogacy, if that's what you choose to do. There are obviously some qualifiers to that. You might die before the child is born. You may run out of patience, but typically a surrogacy journey is 18 months to 2 years, at worst it'll be 4 years. That's normally if something medical goes wrong, not normally legal complications, but medical stuff. If you run out of money, so you've heard the money figures before, and if you're not prepared to use a donor, because it may be some reason to have a donor. And I'm just trying to move this forward. There we go. So, of course, the whole purpose of surrogacy is to have a baby, but the first thing I want to talk about is the egg donor laws. So as you can see with that screen, it is an offence up to 15 years in jail in Australia to pay an egg donor other than her reasonable expenses, whatever they might be. And if you live in the ACT, Victoria or Tasmania, it's okay to go overseas for egg donors. It's also okay in Queensland, New South Wales, South Australia, WA and the Northern Territory, but it's got to be planned carefully because there are provisions in the criminal law, for example, the Crimes Act in New South Wales, which are called long arm provisions, and they might stretch outside of New South Wales, for example. So it's just important to be careful of those and properly planned. There shouldn't be any problem with those at all. I'll just move on to the next slide. If you have a US egg donor, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine has specified a limit typically of $5,000 to $10,000 US to pay the egg donor for her fee. There's been a court case with the American Society of Reproductive Medicine, a group of disgruntled egg donors wanted to be paid more, and that case has been settled. I don't know yet if it's been approved by a judge, but it looks like that upper limit of $10,000 is now likely to have gone. And as you've heard, it's important, absolutely essential to manage costs, and it's important to have an experienced egg donor agency. And I was really pleased to hear the comment before about the choice that you have with egg donors. Children have a right to know where they've come from, and we might take it for granted that we know where we've come from, but we have the risk that when we bring children into the world and we have an anonymous donor, they may not know. And there are certainly people in Australia who complain long and loud that they have been conceived when they were children and they don't know ultimately where they've come from. I'll just go on to the next slide. One of the features about Australia is it's a federation like the US, and unfortunately every state has different rules. So we've got eight sets of rules, or nine if you include federal law. So the first thing is that altruistic surrogacy, so where you don't pay a fee to the surrogate, is allowed everywhere. In effect, it's not allowed, not available in the Northern Territory because the NT doesn't have any laws on surrogacy. So that has a good feature in that you can do what you like. The bad feature is that the two key aims of surrogacy are to have a baby and to be recognised as the parents. You'll have the baby, but you'll never be recognised as the parents. The laws in each state have a residence requirement so that if, for instance, you live in Queensland, you can only undertake surrogacy in Queensland. It'll be a Queensland surrogacy arrangement, and so on. And there's no discrimination in Queensland, New South Wales and Victoria. But unfortunately, there is discrimination in other places. In the ACT, both sides need to be a couple. So if you're single in the ACT, you can't pursue surrogacy. The ACT is probably not so much of a problem because you just go across the border to Queanbeyan. Tasmania, everyone needs to live in Tasmania when signing up. You can get a dispensation from a magistrate at the conclusion of the process, but that's 18 months after the event. In South Australia, singles and same-sex couples aren't able to access surrogacy. Now, South Australia is talking about changing its laws. The Wetherill government has talked about that, and there's currently a review underway, but I don't know how long that review process might take. So for the moment at least, it's not available in South Australia. And in Western Australia, single men and gay couples aren't able to access surrogacy. That's because of the way the Surrogacy Act is drafted. When the baby Gammy saga struck in 2014, which of course was in WA, at that stage WA was undertaking a review of its Surrogacy Act, and I certainly put submissions in to say, look, you should remove this discrimination, but rather than get rid of the Act entirely, the Health Minister said, no, we're not going to make changes to the Act. So I don't anticipate that that discrimination will go anytime soon. So we'll just go on to the next slide. I'm not having any luck moving the slides forward. There we go. Can I have some help, please? Because I can't move that.
Yeah. Did you hear?
I was just having. If for some reason it wasn't moving.
Okay.
I just want to mention briefly, and there was some statements before about HIV positive intended parents. It can be problematic to have Australian clinics provide IVF services. I've certainly had some difficulty for clients who fall in that category. And as you've heard before, Circle has extensive experience working with HIV positive intended parents. So if you have HIV, it's not the end of the game to undertake surrogacy. It's certainly not. It's just a very careful and carefully considered process. Going overseas, if you live in Melbourne, Hobart or Darwin, it's legal to go overseas. If you live in Brisbane, anywhere in Queensland, there is a risk of up to 3 years jail under the Surrogacy Act in Queensland. And I say it's a risk of up to that because no one's been prosecuted. And these laws have been in place forever, but Parliament has never seen fit to enforce the laws. The police don't do anything about them. A family court judge referred a couple of couples who went to Thailand to the Director of Prosecutions in Queensland, who then took no action. New South Wales, there's a risk of up to 2 years jail under the New South Wales Surrogacy Act, but again, no one in New South Wales has ever been prosecuted. The ACT, there's a risk of up to a year's jail, and again, no one's been prosecuted. There's been noises about prosecution, but again, it's never happened. South Australia changed its laws in July last year, and on the face of it, you need the Attorney General's consent before undertaking any surrogacy overseas, whether it's commercial or otherwise. And the Attorney General has to be guided by two documents, regulations, which don't exist, and the state framework for altruistic surrogacy, which also doesn't exist. So it's a bit crazy. And when I've looked at the law there, you can, I think, lawfully undertake surrogacy from South Australia overseas, but you've got to be very careful. And if you live in South Australia, come and talk to me, because you've just got to know what the risks are. And WA, it's possible that you might be committing a criminal offence if you go overseas, but again, if it's properly planned, it's legal. So we'll just go on to the next slide. Oh, gone back one. If you're going overseas, then of course, one of the things you want to establish is citizenship for your child. This is under Section 16 of the Australian Citizenship Act, which is federal legislation. It's what is called citizenship by descent. And essentially, if a person has a parent who is an Australian citizen, so you only need one parent who's an Australian citizen, and that person is born outside Australia, then that person can apply for Australian citizenship. It's called citizenship by descent in its common jargon, and the Department of Immigration thought that there needed to be a genetic link, but a court case 6 years ago established that there doesn't need to be a genetic link. The Department of Immigration had called the Australian Citizenship Instructions. These aren't law, but they're the guidebook for departmental officers to determine citizenship applications for anyone, including babies who've been born overseas through surrogacy. And they say very clearly that if there isn't a genetic link, we're going to look at it very, very closely. But the reality is that if you undertake surrogacy in the United States, there are two ways to rely upon citizenship and by descent. And one is by DNA, and the other, which is an alternative, is by way of an order. So in all US states other than Illinois, orders are made for surrogacy where surrogacy is available. Illinois, it's possible to do it by way of order. And as a result, there shouldn't be any difficulty obtaining citizenship. And the benefits in going to the United States, it's a transparent, straightforward process. One of the features about agency that Scott was talking about before is that anyone can set up an agency. So it's really a case of buyer beware. You've really got to be looking at agencies that have significant experience. You also got to be looking at going to good doctors. There's a recent horror story from the United States where a doctor thought it was entirely appropriate to implant three embryos, so this has now turned into a dramatic court case. So I certainly know that Circle work with some very good IVF doctors, very reputable IVF doctors, who also have good bedside manner. One of the key features about a good surrogacy agency is good matching, so that you can feel confident that the surrogate that you're dealing with is someone that you're entirely comfortable with. And one of the things I'd like to feature or discuss is that you have an ongoing relationship with the surrogate and possibly the donor. Now, I would encourage you to have a look at a program, download it from the web, called from SBS Insight. There are two episodes, and I have to say I was in both of them, but that's not why I recommend them. You can download them for free. One is from 2011 called Baby Business, and the other's from September 2014 called Surrogacy. And they just give you a good insight as to the surrogacy process. The 2011 one really shows the kind of process that's involved with Circle, namely that you have intended parents who had boys, and the boys are interviewed in the show, and those boys know their surrogate and they have a good ongoing relationship with her. And one of the key features about going to the United States that just can't be emphasised enough is that at the end of the process, the end of the legal process, we have judges involved. And it might be a pre-birth order that you find in places like California, or it might be a post-birth order as you find in some other states, but judges are there and they are reviewing the entire process, so that if in the unusual event that something goes wrong, and I'm not aware of any case with Circle having gone wrong, but if it does, then judges are available. And this contrasts with any of the developing countries that you can think of that Australians have gone to, where they've relied on contract and they have not relied on judicial process, they haven't relied on judges. And I think that's really one of the great strengths about the US. Just move on to the next one. Oh, I've gone too far. The risks in going to the US, as I said, it might be a criminal offence, so you've got to be very careful about that. Agencies aren't regulated, as I said, buy and beware. And as Scott was discussing at length, you've got to keep a lid on healthcare costs. Now, one of the things I like about Circle is that they're really focused on that issue. That's, aside from the legal issue about whether it's legal or not, that's the biggest risk for any Aussies going to the United States. Your healthcare costs, the insurance costs, can blow right out if you haven't managed it properly at the beginning. I've had clients who have come to me after having had twins and spending $1 million simply because they didn't manage it. They didn't get advice and they didn't follow it through carefully at the beginning. And that's one of the things that Circle are very, very careful about and very particular about, and I really like. You should also be concerned, of course, about exchange rate variations. The Aussie dollar and the US dollar are bouncing around now, and the good news is that our dollar is going up. In terms of managing costs, there isn't an obligation, even though Circle are based in Boston, to go to a doctor in Boston. If you live on the east coast of Australia, Sydney, Brisbane or Melbourne, you will be on one plane flight over to LA, which will take 13 or 14 hours. You may go to an IVF clinic in Los Angeles or an IVF clinic in Las Vegas, for instance, and there are doctors there who do lots of work with Australians. If you're from Perth, then you're probably going to end up on the east coast of the US because it's easier to get to. And we've talked at length about health insurance for the surrogate and the baby, and I don't think I need to cover that any further. There's been a lot of talk of late about going to Canada. Where it's possible, I prefer the US. And the reason for that is the legal landscape in the US is more certain, although it's patchy. And why I say it's patchy, Well, you've got 51 jurisdictions, but you go to a good agency such as Circle and they will guide you to the places that are okay. They're not going to put you in places that aren't okay. The legal landscape in Canada is much more uncertain in my view. It's also patchy because it's a federation, but Canada, there are two agencies there that operate in a grey area. I'll just say that. It's certainly clear for Circle that they are operating legally and lawfully, and they've been going a very long time. As you've heard, they're one of the world's oldest and largest surrogacy agencies, so they're obviously doing something right. The second thing is that surrogates and donors are readily available. You don't have necessarily the same experience in Canada. And one of the temptations about going to Canada is, costs are so much cheaper. Well, I don't agree with that. If costs are properly managed, and that's the key to it, if you properly manage the cost, then the costs are not terribly different between the US and Canada. And as you can see there, you rely on experienced agencies. You don't go to agencies that don't know what they're doing. And I've lost count of the number of times that clients have said to me, oh, you know, you must have heard about this particular agency that they found on the web. Well, that's and a lot of the time I just haven't. And these are agencies set up by anybody, and they've been going a fairly short time. They often don't know what they're doing, and it may work or it might be highly risky. An experienced agency like Circle, they know what they're doing, and chances of something going wrong like that are very, very low. And as I said out there, the surrogacy journey in the US is 18 to 24 months with a smooth journey. This is assuming that all the medical stuff goes okay. If there's some dramas with the medical stuff, it can take up to 4 years. And coming back home, it'll happen, as you can see from the slide, in this order. First off, there will be a US court order. That'll often be a pre-birth order, sometimes it'll be a post-birth order. There will be a US birth certificate from the Office of Vital Statistics, which will name you as the parents. You'll then be able to, without any difficulty at all, obtain a US passport, and armed with that, get a visa to come back to Australia and straight through the airport. So whether you land in Brisbane or Sydney or Melbourne or, for that matter, Perth, there won't be any dramas coming back in, and you apply for Australian citizenship back home. I strongly recommend not applying for Australian citizenship in the United States because you stay there until citizenship is granted. So if for some reason it's going to take 3 months, suddenly you're stuck in the United States for 3 months when you could be at home in the comfort of your home and earning money. Who's a parent? One of the unfortunate features about Australian law at the moment is that it is uncertain about whether you'll be a parent. You'll be a parent for citizenship purposes, no problem about that. And you will be able to get, therefore, a citizenship certificate for your child. Armed with that and the birth certificate, you can then get a Medicare card and therefore, of course, get Centrelink benefits, which means you can take your child to the hospital at 2 a.m. If you think your child is about to die from chronic diarrhoea. You can enrol your child at daycare and school. These are the things that parents wouldn't really worry about. But what about other purposes? Well, you want to make sure that you have a will in place, actually specifically naming your child, and I'd help you through that process. But there's certainly been some talk about, well, maybe we should go to the family court to get orders for a declaration of parentage. Generally, I don't recommend that, and the reason for that is this. If you come from a state where you committed an offence undertaking surrogacy in the US, well, why would you be going to the family court and saying, I committed an offence or we committed an offence and please refer us to authorities? Secondly, there has been a difference of opinion by family court judges about whether or not you're parents. Some judges have formed the view that the surrogate and her husband are the parents, Another judge has formed the view that if you're the genetic parents, therefore you're the parents. Another judge has said he's not making a declaration as to whether or not you're the parents. And in fact, there's an appeal from that judge currently underway that not a lawyer's handling. So hopefully we will have some clarity in the law later this year, but at the moment it's just simply a mess. And I don't recommend that you spend tens of thousands of dollars of your hard-earned money for what might be a fairly pointless legal process. An alternative process might be to get registration of the orders. So that's what that involves, is the orders and some other paperwork would be sent by us to the family court. And if the family court accepts them, then the order that's made overseas will be accepted as an order made in Australia. So that will say, for all purposes under Australian law, that you are the parents. This has come about because of a case that was decided in 2013. I've got two of these registration applications underway at the moment, and they seem to be stuck in the family court. So it's a watch this space. So for most people, the option is really probably do nothing further, but the law in this area is a moving feast, and we just need to see where it goes. Currently, there is an inquiry being undertaken by the House of Representatives, and it's likely that that inquiry will come back with a report by early May, just in case Malcolm Turnbull gets a double dissolution. And that report is likely to recommend making it easier going to the United States and Canada. That's one thing that I've strongly pushed with the committee. However, I don't see that there's going to be any change there for a number of years. You may have also seen in the media that there has been talk about a proposed Hague Convention about international surrogacy. This is an international body based at The Hague, and Australia is a member country, as is the United States. I don't see that there is going to be any convention in place for 3 to 4 years. So I don't think we need to worry about that for the moment. It's not going to make things any more difficult. I think I'm done, and see if we have any questions.
So it looks like we have one question for now, which we'll answer. And in the meantime, feel free to type in other questions using that questions box to the right of your screen. So the first question is for Stephen. What do you mean when you say that it could be a criminal offense?
Sorry, just say that one again.
The question is, what do you mean when you say that surrogacy could be a criminal offense?
Okay. It depends on the state. But let's talk about New South Wales, for instance. In New South Wales, it is an offence to enter into or to offer to enter into a commercial surrogacy arrangement overseas. And that's punishable by up to 2 years imprisonment. In the ACT, it's the same offence, but it's for 1 year. In South Australia, it's an offence on its face to undertake surrogacy overseas without obtaining the permission of the State Attorney General. But as I said, with that law, I think with careful planning, that requirement can be evaded. In Queensland, there are two offences. One is entering into or offering to enter into the commercial surrogacy arrangement. And the other offence is making payment under a commercial surrogacy arrangement. Queensland has, it's interesting, Queensland has a time limit for prosecution of a year. After the offence has been committed. There isn't a time limit in New South Wales, and from recollection in the ACT, there's a time limit for prosecution of a year.
And Stephen, thank you. I just want to add one thing in here. We have worked with Australian clients in the past, and we have never had any issues returning to Australia. None of them have been prosecuted criminally. And in fact, we've never, as you've mentioned, we've never had any issues establishing the parental rights of any of our intended parents or getting them home. And so while it is something that is scary when you look at it, if you work with agencies that have experience doing it and lawyers in the country they're going back to, you can navigate the waters successfully.
Yeah, look, no, as I said before, no one's been prosecuted.
No.
Not one person has been prosecuted for those surrogacy offences. Not one person has been prosecuted as for those egg donor offences. You know, I remember one client of Circle. She was a single woman living in New South Wales, and she was a bit of a warrior. And she undertook her surrogacy, and then she returned to Sydney, and she said, "What's going to happen when I get off the plane? Am I going to get the tap on the shoulder by the police?" I said, "No, that's not going to happen. What's going to happen is you're going to be carrying your baby, and you're going to go through immigration and, you know, have your passport and so on, and walk out the other side." And she said, "Are you sure that's going to happen? You know, I'm really worried about it." And then after the event, she contacted me and said, "Would you believe I landed at Sydney Airport and I went through customs and immigration and I walked out the other side and no one asked me any questions?" And I said, "Well, surprise, surprise. That's exactly how the process works."
So the next question is, will a child be a dual citizen?
And Stephen, from the U.S. perspective, yes. The United States allows dual citizenship. Does Australia as well?
Absolutely. And one of the common features about Australia is, of course, many people have dual citizenship already. It's not unusual for me to see clients who have dual or triple citizenship. For example, they might have Australian, New Zealand and UK citizenship. Or had some clients recently who had Argentinian, Irish and Italian citizenship plus Australian citizenship between the two of them. And their child might therefore be entitled to, in fact, citizenship of five countries. That's not unusual. So that's just part of the mix. But in terms of obtaining Australian citizenship, the process is pretty straightforward. And what would normally happen would be that you'd come and see me, or we'd do it by Skype, and then we'd plan it. And the sooner we do that, the better. And for the obtaining the citizenship, I'd refer you to a migration agent, because they're the people who cover citizenship applications.
The next question is for Stephen. Do you think that surrogacy is a better option than local adoption in Australia, which is a lot cheaper?
Oh, well, you know, now we're talking about reality, dreams as opposed to reality. The dream would be, for many people, let's adopt a child because there are all these children available and, you know, they're doing a really, really hard time. The reality is that there are very, very few kids available for adoption. I have lost count of the number of clients who've come in to me and said, "We wanted to undertake adoption, but we couldn't. There were no kids. We have been waiting years." And this is assuming, of course, that the law doesn't discriminate. If you've got gay couples or singles, then in some parts of Australia, you can't undertake adoption. The average wait for adoption, if you're on the list, and they haven't decided to chop you from the list. We saw disgracefully about 3 years ago, Australian intended parents who are on the list to adopt from Ethiopia, that Australia said, "No, we're not adopting any more from Ethiopia." And these people had been on the list for, I think, about 8 years, were suddenly told that they were just being dropped into the middle of nowhere. In other words, they were waiting and now they're on no one's list. But the contrast between adoption and surrogacy is that with adoption, you're chasing a pipe dream. At some stage, there may be a child there and you will probably wait 5 to 8 years, if you're lucky, and if there isn't discrimination against you, because there are just so few children available either within Australia or internationally. As compared to surrogacy, where if things go right, you will be a parent in 18 to 24 months, 1.5 to 2 years. What a contrast. If things go really, really badly, which isn't very common, but if they go really, really badly medically, it might be 4 years. That's it. even at its worst, it's quicker than the best journey with adoption.
And Stephen, I would just add from our experience as well, obviously I'm not familiar with Australian adoption, but I know in the United States, a lot of people like surrogacy because of the control over all of it, the control over who is carrying your child. You know that even if she ever did try to change her mind, which is we've never had to deal with that situation, but if it did occur, you have a signed contract that can be enforced in a U.S. court. And also in the United States, you can be restricted on who can adopt. And so that is one of those things. I know you're talking about discrimination. There are age limits. There are, you know, limits on, you know, in different countries on, you know, same-sex couples. And so, you know, surrogacy opens it up to a number of people that wouldn't be eligible to adopt in certain countries.
Absolutely. And can I say the United States on adoption is much better than Australia on a per capita basis. You know, recently I was at a seminar in London where a noted US adoption attorney complained about the crashing of numbers of adoption in the United States because of the Hague Inter-Country Adoption Convention, which makes it hard for kids to move from country to country. But even so, the adoption rate in the United States is at least 3 to 4 times per head of population than that of Australia. We have the worst rate in the developed world. So anyone who thinks that they might get a child through adoption, what they're going to get is a world of pain, and they're looking at 5 to 8 years, maybe 10 years, because I think the rates are getting worse. We now have the lowest rate of adoption that we've ever had, I think, in the last 40 or 50 years, in absolute terms as well as in per capita terms. Anyone who thinks that they're going through adoption is crazy. You know, if I had a choice between adoption and surrogacy, no question about it, I'd go through surrogacy.
Thank you, Stephen. So the next question is, how about if the U.S. lawyer makes, I think it's supposed to be the contract sound non-commercial, will that still be a criminal offense? I'll give that to you in 1 second, Stephen, but the one thing I would say is in our contracts, we do, number one, we have a law firm here as well, so all the payments and everything can be sent to the Weltman Law Group, so you don't see that it's going to a surrogate parenting agency. And number two, the contract is drafted such that it all talks about pregnancy reimbursements. It doesn't actually say fees, and that's necessary in some countries. For example, in the UK, you know, it's similar. They have to be pregnancy reimbursement. So the contract is already drafted that way, but can you speak a little bit more about whether or not the language in the contract can make it not seem commercial?
Yeah, you've got to be careful with the contract. Now, I'd obviously have to look at the contract and make a call on how the contract appears and what's the reality. So that's something that we just need to be very, very careful about. I've certainly seen some contracts from the US that appear very clearly to be altruistic, not commercial. So it's just taking care with the process.
The one thing we can't do in a contract is, obviously, if you are giving her a $25,000, $30,000 payment, it has to be in there in some respect. We can't just draft it as if she's not getting paid because, you know, a surrogate and her attorney would not allow that. And so, you know, the payments have to be in there, but it doesn't say payment. It says a reimbursement for pregnancy-related expenses. Next question. For Stephen, you said you could be residents of New South Wales, but can be managed if we were to use a commercial surrogate. Does that mean it may not be necessary to relocate to Victoria or use Circle and still be legal?
My view is that if you want to be legal about it, then you would move from New South Wales to, say, Victoria. But the starting point is to come in and get advice first. Very simple. So that, you know, I've talked in general terms today, but, you know, everyone's case is different. So it's just having to see what your particular circumstances are to work out what's best for you. And look, I'll give a really simple example of clients of mine who are going overseas. They lived in Bega, which is very close to the Victorian border. They were employees of the New South Wales state government, so there was potential that they might be committing some kind of offence. And on my advice, they rented a house 20 minutes drive away, which was in Victoria. And they commuted every day from that house at the relevant time, which is the time of entering into the commercial surrogacy arrangement. So it's not a term of life imprisonment. It's a particular period. So we need to work out how long they might have to move for. And they just commuted from that house to their work every day, and life went on, and of course they did it all lawfully. So it's just having to be careful and see what your particular circumstances are so that they can be properly planned.
Okay, the next question. I'm an Australian now living and working in New Zealand, married to a New Zealander. Just wondering if there's any cases on bringing a baby home to New Zealand through Circle Surrogacy. Yes, we have worked with New Zealand before. Just as we work with Stephen, we have an attorney in New Zealand that, you know, I'd be happy to connect you to. I actually just had a New Zealand a couple of intended parents from New Zealand signed on last month. And so, you know, we do work with New Zealand. There really aren't any issues there either. You can return home. We've never had any issues with that. In this instance, what I would probably suggest is that you speak with both Stephen about the citizenship to an extent, and then also talk to New Zealand counsel. But you know, if we did a consultation, we can give you that name and give you more information. But we have had New Zealand clients and never had any concerns with them either.
When you live in New Zealand and you undertake surrogacy overseas, you have to go through some basic checks like adoption. And you get an adoption. It sounds really weird that you're adopting your own child, but you get an adoption order at the end of it from the family court in New Zealand. And it's very common for trans-Tasman matters, so Australians living in New Zealand or New Zealanders living in Australia. So I work very closely with New Zealand Council. And you know, one of the features that I think is essential with surrogacy when it's international is that it's a team effort, so that you're placed at the centre of the whole process, because it's your journey, of course, and people who form that team, so for example it's me or Circle or the lawyer in New Zealand, work together as part of that team to problem solve for you.
Okay, thank you. So on a similar basis or similar line of thought, what happens if both parents are permanent residents and not citizens?
It's the same deal in terms of the any offences that might be committed here. But in terms of bringing your baby home, it'll be based on the visa that you've got in Australia. So the process is essentially very similar. And I've had a number of clients who've been permanent residents or under some visa in Australia, and they've been able to bring their babies home to Australia, no dramas.
Okay. So a question for Amanda. For overseas intended parents, how many visits to the U.S. are recommended?
So there would be 2 required visits plus additional recommended visits. The 2 required would be if you are contributing biology to your embryos, sperm or egg, you will need to come to the United States at least once to do some testing. If you are the biological father, you would need to leave sperm samples at your IVF clinic. If you are an intended mother donating your eggs, you would need you would likely be able to do the majority of the process in Australia and then just travel over for when it's actually time to do your egg retrieval. So that would be the first visit to actually get your testing done in the United States. It has to be done in the United States because our Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, requires that it's done in the United States. The second required visit would be at the very end of the process to come pick up your baby, which is the exciting part. Most intended parents want to be there for the delivery. A lot of surrogates want you in the delivery room as well, and you're able to do that if you feel comfortable. In addition to those 2 visits, a lot of intended parents like to come over at least once or twice once they have their surrogate in place to meet her either when she's going for her medical screening at the IVF clinic, it's a safe place to meet, rather than having to travel to her home, and you may not feel as comfortable. If you're meeting at the clinic, it can feel a little bit less scary or less uncomfortable. And then a lot of intended parents like to come over for the big ultrasound during the pregnancy, right around 20 weeks of pregnancy, where they measure the full anatomy of the baby. You can find out the sex if you don't already know. It's an exciting time in the pregnancy. You can visit the hospital where the baby will be born, and you can meet the surrogate's family if you haven't already done that. Now, we're not naive. We understand that for international intended parents, traveling four times overseas is not easy. So the only two required visits would be for the medical aspects in the very beginning, and then to pick up your baby at the very end. And then the additional visits are up to you. So the next question is, what if, I'm sorry.
Just, can I just comment on that?
Of course.
I generally recommend that clients go over three times as a minimum, so that you also have a relationship with your surrogate. I think that's really important. And in terms of creating embryos, it is possible to create embryos in parts of Australia with subsidy from the federal government. So this will be, your IVF costs will be considerably lower. It is possible to have those embryos, this, if you don't need an egg donor, if you need an egg donor, then there may be an issue. And it's possible to have these embryos then transported to the United States and used for IVF there. FDA, or Food and Drug Administration, US requirement is needed. Some doctors in the United States say that they can't work with that, with embryos created in Australia, but there's at least one doctor who works closely with Circle as well. It's a very good doctor, and it's convenient to those east coast of Australia who is comfortable with that process. So you may save considerable money by properly planning that process. And of course, that's the IVF costs. It's not the surrogacy costs through Circle.
Thank you, Stephen. And to comment a little bit more on that, what you just brought up, the FDA in the United States does require, does oversee the IVF process. And generally, the FDA says that, number one, everything has to be done in an FDA lab, and number two, that certain testing must be done. Now, one of the main exceptions to that rule is if you create embryos for your own use, they can be then used in the United States. And so I believe what you're speaking about is for heterosexual couples. Now, if you're using an egg donor, I do not believe that it works, and I don't know that it would work for a same-sex couple. But if you create embryos for your own use in the United, no matter where you are in the world, you can then use them, you know, in the United States. The other thing I would say is I know that doctor also has had concerns with the way that they were created sometimes abroad. They weren't grown to day five. They were frozen on day one or two. And they haven't, when they unfreeze them, they haven't had good success with them. So I would encourage you to speak with a U.S. doctor in before you create embryos anywhere else, just to ensure that you don't waste time and money there and, you know, and subject a woman to, you know, unnecessary IVF process if you can't do it. So if you know that you are considering going to the U.S., I would talk with a U.S. doctor before you do anything anywhere else as well.
And look, I agree entirely with that. It's one of the features about undertaking surrogacy is it's a complex process. It's not as though the two of you are having sex and then produce a baby. You are involving a battery of counsellors, doctors and lawyers in the process, and maybe a judge at the end of the process to have a baby. Prevention is better than cure. It's better to plan these things. I certainly wouldn't recommend that you go off to your local IVF clinic and then produce some embryos and then flick them off to the United States. It's got to be properly planned. So that'll be something that I could talk to you about, how to do that, and make sure that you're also talking to the doctor in the United States so that it's properly planned there, so it's all set up correctly at the beginning. But if you are able to do it the right way, you may save considerable money.
Okay. Next question. What if the child wants to return to the U.S. when he or she is of legal age? Are the parents able to obtain citizenship to accompany? So the child, as a U.S. citizen, if you maintain the citizenship, is always able to come here. I'm not an immigration specialist by any means. I more do contracts and insurance, and my colleague Dean does more of the legal work at the end, and neither of us are general immigration attorneys. My understanding would be that I don't believe that the child having U.S. citizenship would ever grant the intended parent or the parent's citizenship. It may allow them to get a green card, but you really should speak with an immigration specialist. And, you know, if you're interested, when we do a consultation, we're always happy to connect you to somebody that could, you know, help you with that as well.
And I can't help you with that. You know, with what Scott has said is that, you know, you obviously need to get some advice from a migration attorney in the U.S.
Yeah. Next question. The health check and the vaccines for the baby will be paid. Will be paid the insurance, or we have to pay separately? So when we're talking about the child's expenses, those are the dependent charges. And again, this depends a lot upon what you are doing. If you're trying for a single child and you wanted to get a pre-birth order to return quicker, you would be paying the medical expenses yourself. And that's where typically the $2,000 to $3,000 would include the newborn, you know, newborn staying a night or two in the hospital, and, you know, the normal newborn screening, which includes the vaccines and all the care for the child. With twins, we would be using the surrogate's insurance, and that would be covered by the surrogate's insurance. The next question was, for the purposes of clarity, the total cost is about $162,000 for GSED and the IVF multiple tries. Are there any other costs apart from travel and accommodation? I guess I'm trying to understand the worst case scenario. I would encourage you to go to our website and go to the cost section, and there's a cost sheet, and it shows you at the end all of the different things that can come up. You know, you could have canceled cycles, you could have multiple failed transfers. You can look at the fixed fee cost sheet, where if you are worried about the worst case scenario, I believe you pay us about $10,000 more than we normally collect, and we would take on the risks of the carriers and the egg donor expenses. So it's very hard to tell you exactly what the worst case scenario could be. What I would tell you is many agencies lie about the cost. You just have to make sure you understand what you're paying. We put on our cost sheet the average expenses for each line item for one transfer, one child. Twins will be a little bit more. Additional transfers will cost a little bit more. You know, and again, you can, even within the average, you can keep the cost down. But in terms of worst case scenario, IVF clinics will allow you to buy an unlimited IVF plan. We'll allow you to buy a fixed fee program, and our fees, even in our general program, are fixed already.
One of the things I like about Circle is that Circle is very focused on this issue of cost and don't lie about what the overall cost is. There are any number of agencies in the United States who hide some of the costs from intended parents, and it's hidden in the fine print, and then they get surprises on the way through. I hate surprises, particularly in a surrogacy journey. As I said before, prevention is better than cure. I'd rather people be upfront about where they're going, and Circle are very good at that.
It's in nobody's best interest not to understand what the cost of this process is. Next question. What are the benefits of going through an agency as compared to going through an IVF clinic first? The IVF clinic will ultimately liaise with an agency anyways. Yes and no. IVF clinics, you need an IVF clinic and you need a surrogacy agency. The reality is the longest waiting period will be for the surrogate herself. So some people have already started with the IVF clinic, but since the surrogate is coming through the agency and the egg donor is typically coming through the agency, many people choose to start with the agency. But really, it's up to you. Some agencies will say you have to work with certain IVF clinics and vice versa. I don't think that's the right approach. I think you should be able to choose your agency on your own, and I think you should be able to choose your IVF clinic on your own. So we will make recommendations, but you can always work with whomever you want. And if you wanted to start with an IVF clinic, by all means, you could.
My view is that there is great benefit working with an agency if you're going to the United States. If you try and do it on your own, you're nuts. A good agency like Circle helps focus the process on the way through and gets rid of a lot of the bumps in the road, and I think that's absolutely essential. If you were to choose the way to do it, the way to do it, in my view, is you go to the agency first and then you go to the IVF clinic second. But look, there are any number of good IVF doctors, and if you're from the East Coast, there's any number that I've worked with who also work with Circle who are excellent doctors. But go to the agency first, and then you go to the doctor second.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. So the next question: how long will we be able to take the children? How long before we can take the children back after the birth? So I think this comes down to both, you know, the health issues, but also the legal issues. If Amanda, you want to start with the health first?
Yeah. So in terms of the end of the process, we would help you, first of all, make your travel arrangements based on the due date, when we expect the baby to arrive, the circumstances of the birth, whether it would be a vaginal delivery or a C-section, and, of course, the carrier and what she knows from her doctor. If the baby is healthy at birth, he or she can typically leave a hospital in about 2 days, as well as the surrogate, and then the remaining time that you would spend in the United States, it's about 2 to 4 weeks after you leave the hospital, depending on the legal work that's involved.
Yeah, and the legal work really depends, dictates a lot of this. If you do a pre-birth order, and again, if you do a pre-birth order, you cannot use the surrogate's insurance to cover the medical bills. But if you do a pre-birth order so that everybody knows from the very beginning that you're the parents, the initial birth certificate has your names on it, then you don't have to do, you don't have to stay around to do legal work. So all you have to do is wait for the birth certificate to be issued, which still can take a week or two. We would tell you plan on 2 to 4 weeks, because you basically wait for the baby to be released from the hospital, and then you get the birth certificate, and then you get the U.S. passport to return home. On the other hand, if you're using the surrogate's insurance to cover the babies, then you, it's a longer process. At that point in time, you have to wait for the babies to be released from the hospital, and then you file the legal work, and that will take, I would say, at least 2 to 4 weeks more to get heard by the U.S. court. So you will be in the United States longer. That is one of the trade-offs with getting the insurance to be able to use the, you know, to be able to cover the children.
The experience of my clients in going to the U.S. for surrogacy is typically 2 to 4 weeks post-birth.
Okay, just a couple more questions, it looks like. We have genetically tested frozen embryos in Melbourne. I don't know how I say it. Melbourne. Brian's Melbourne. Trying to tell me how to say it. How do I say it, Stephen?
Melbourne.
Ready to be cryo-shipped. What will be the approximate cost for the title process for gestational surrogacy, the total process, and how many minimum visits will be needed? I think we've gone through a lot of that. The shipping, it probably costs a couple thousand dollars. You do have to make sure that the embryos were created that could be used in the United States. And as Amanda said, the minimum number would be 2. Stephen suggested 3 visits. We would suggest 3 or 4. Stephen, anything else on that one?
Yeah, look, you're talking about Victoria. So Victoria has some specific problems. It depends on whether the embryos contain any donor gametes. So if there's an egg donor, then, for example, you can't export out of Victoria without permission of the state regulator. The IVF clinics can't export from Australia if it is to facilitate commercial surrogacy, but lo and behold, some of them do. And it's knowing which clinics do and which clinics don't. And I'm familiar with all of that. So it'd just be a case of talking with me and seeing whether it's possible. But assuming that you can export out of Victoria, out of Australia, you've still got to go back to the basic. Can it be used in the United States? And that's the very point that Scott just made.
Okay. So it looks like the last question we have, I'll read it in a second. Before I read that, I just want to say thank you to everybody for being on this. Thank you, Stephen, for taking your time on a Saturday morning. If you have additional questions, you don't feel comfortable asking the group, feel free to email us. And if you wanted to meet when we're, you know, either when we're in Australia visiting, or if you want to do a Skype call beforehand, we would be happy to talk to you guys.
So the last question is for Circle. How do you verify the family health history of the egg donors is correct and accurate, or going beyond just asking, other than just going there, or do you go beyond just asking the donor for the details?
So like I mentioned when I was speaking about the egg donors earlier, we ask all egg donors for their family health history on their application, and you can go ahead and read that when you're reviewing all donor profiles. Of course, we can't always confirm that what people say is accurate. There may be things in their family history that they don't know about. So when your donor goes for her medical screening with your IVF doctor, they will meet with a genetic counselor, and they will talk about their family genetics. And then she will undergo a full genetic panel to see if she is a carrier of any genetic diseases or genetic abnormalities. If there is something that, if she tests positive for a specific genetic disease, the doctor will then speak to you about next steps. Just because something comes up in her family history doesn't mean that she's automatically disqualified. It really would depend on what your family genetics are as well. So thank you once again for joining us.
Stephen, any final comments?
Just one. Thank you, everyone, for taking your time for this. And I just mentioned that you see the upcoming Australian events. The consultations in Brisbane are also timed with the Families Through Surrogacy Conference, so that if you're contemplating going there, you'll also have the opportunity to meet the people from Circle while you're in Brisbane.
Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. And again, if you have any other questions, feel free to give us an email. There's an email on the screen here. And we'd be happy to answer anything else. Okay. Thank you, guys.
See you.
Bye. Bye, Stephen.